I've had a good day already, dude.
Yeah, it's been all right, hasn't it?
Day up north in Grimsby, my first time here. I'm with Thomas Turgoose in his car. Well, actually, his missus's car, right?
Yes.
She left you with the one with the least fuel in. That's her
move.
She's
good at that. She'll get in the car in the morning, or she'll check them both, and whichever's got the most fuel, that's the one she'll take.
So you're left with this today.
Yeah.
But we got enough fuel to get down to the seafront, which is what we're looking at now. I've just eaten the most delicious plate of fish and chips.
Are you just I genuinely mean it.
Well, you bigged it up. You said it's the best fish and chips in the world.
Yeah.
I said that's a big claim. And because I'm pescatarian, so I switched to a non-meat diet about 2 years ago. So my go-to dish when I'm at a pub is fish and chips, because generally the veggie option in pubs is usually pretty shit.
Yeah.
So I'll go fish and chips as my go-to dish. So I've had the best of the best all over the world. And I would say, dude, it's the chips was the main thing. The chips were like cooked to perfection.
Well, it's the place that I've always gone since I was a kid, Steele's. Give them a quick
shout. If you're in town.
Steele's Corner House in Cleethorpes.
Lovely staff as well. And a real nice old school setting, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. It's like you walk in and it's literally like nothing's happened since the 70s. It's, it's good. It's good. But the food's the main thing.
I almost went jumbo and I'm so glad I didn't. I had medium, you had small. I couldn't finish mine.
Yeah, well,
and
I
now I've got the chip sweats in your car.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I'm having now. I mean, I'd say I had a salad just before you turned up just because I was a bit like, just trying to eat properly. And then as soon as I walked in, I was like,
it's too good to resist, isn't it, that smell?
Yeah.
So I want to go dark with you from the outset, if that's okay.
Yeah.
On a day like this, it's probably the last thing we should be doing. But then it's sort of in fitting with the narrative thread of the film, Eden Lake. I watched it for, I think, the sixth time last night.
Yeah.
And boy, oh boy, like one of my favorite horror films ever made. I think it's so gnarly and brilliantly done. Was that your first role outside of your projects with Shane? Did you do This Is England, Summer's Town, and then was that your first film? Or was it Scouting?
So
Scouting
for me,
book before that?
I went straight from This Is England and went back to Grimsby. And Stephen Graham made a promise to my mum at the rap party saying, I promise you I will never let Tomo just go back to Grimsby and be forgotten. And he kept to his word. And within a couple of months, Stephen,
what a nice dude.
Exactly. That hands down one of the most genuinely, amazingly beautiful people I've ever met. And he rang me and he said, I'm doing this TV series called The Innocence Project. And they want to meet you for an audition. And I was like, what's an audition? Because I've never done one.
Do one for This Is England?
It wasn't really an audition. It was just a...
Just sort of a walk into the room and a...
Just sort of like a chemistry building thing, just sort of having a chat and a little bit of improvisation, but not really an audition as such.
Where you're reading rehearsed lines.
So I had to learn these lines. And I remember I was sat in there and my phone went off.
Good start.
And it was Shane Meadows who was calling me.
Brilliant.
And I answered it as well. Not like now, if my phone went off, I'd be like, oh my God, I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
Whereas it was like, oh, it's Shane. Hey,
all right, mate. I'm just in an audition.
Just an audition. So that was the second job that I ever went on to. So I did about 4 weeks on that. And then it was, and then we went on to Eden Lake, would it have been? Yeah, Eden Lake, and then Summer's Town, Scouting Book. Eden Lake, Summer's Town, and then Scouting Book, and then onwards, yeah.
Wow. And I guess because you were fairly well known as a likeable kind of hero figure from This Is England, Eden Lake is a very different role. But what I love about the way you play the role is, you know, you do some bad stuff in it. You cut out Michael Fassbender's tongue with a Stanley knife. But there's a vulnerability and a likability to you that I think makes you, even when you're doing dastardly stuff, a likable, amiable character. Because there's that beautiful scene where you're hiding in the trees as well, and the actress whose name is...
Kelly Riley.
She's there, and you're kind of like, you can see this look in your eye, you want to help her, don't you? And you go up to her and you go, miss, as if you're about to maybe offer that hand of friendship, and she just goes, bang!
That was exactly how I played it, as if to say, like, I was going to go up and say, look, I'm so sorry about everything that's happened, but if you go this way, go that way. I'll go this way and like send the lads a different way and you can get out. But yeah, she just took it the wrong way. And
you can't blame her, can you?
No,
you can't blame her.
No.
So was that in the script or was that your take on the character?
Just chatting with the director, James Watkins, just sort of like, how are we approaching this? Is he going up because he feels sorry for her? Because straight from the off, you can tell that Cooper didn't want to be there.
Yeah.
And
he's definitely under duress, isn't he?
He's under peer pressure, which is what you see a lot of it nowadays, and maybe not to that extent, but you see a lot of peer pressure nowadays, and I've been a victim of it as well. Well, my lads are telling me to do one more Jägerbomb on a Friday night and I don't want to do it.
Yeah.
But just because the lads are going, do it, it's that similar sort of thing.
Yeah, you don't want to be left out.
You don't want to be left out, so you just do it, and that's exactly what Cooper was doing, but on a bigger scale, you know.
And you had obviously worked with Jack on This Is England, and he in that film is despicable, isn't he? Despicably great.
Yeah, he's brilliant. Yeah, he really, really smashed that. Definitely. Yeah, he's an incredible baddie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me about the scene when you cut out Fassbender's tongue.
Well, that for
shooting that.
The whole experience for that for me was insane, because I remember we shot the pilot with a whole different cast. I think there was only me and Jack who was the same cast from the pilot to the film, and just around all that blood that I'd not seen before, and I had to have my prosthetics and just having knives and just being a bit like, yeah, in the woods. And it was a big budget, so it was all a bit of a mad experience for me. But yeah, doing that, I was obviously it was a rubber knife. Michael was saying, he pulled me aside and he was like, I want you to really go for it, make it look real. And they're the sort of things that you learn from people like Michael. You know, you want it to look as real as possible, and hopefully that's what we did.
And there's that trust there. Is that what it's all about as an actor, with someone that you're going to those levels of the edge with, is you want to have that mutual respect and trust that you both know that the other guy is going to do as well as he can for the scene, and if that involves you being uncomfortable, then that's what the scene requires, that's okay.
Yeah, and that's something I learned from a very young age with Stephen. There was a great scene in This Is England when Combo gets out the car and headbutts Jack O'Connell's character Pukey, and Stephen catches him. You can hear it when you watch the film, you can hear the headbutt, and that was them two saying, right, this is what's happening, but it's all character, you need to trust me, there's a lot of respect involved. And that's exactly what Michael was like. He just said, I know that it might seem like you're hurting me, but you're not. You know, you were doing everything that needs to be done to make it look real and make the audience buy it. So, and I think with horrors as well, you've really got to do that. Otherwise, it can look like corny and shit, can't it? So,
well, what about the scene where Fassbender's character's already dead and he's tied up to his partner and she's still alive and you guys are all pouring petrol on him and then you set him alight? Now, that's obviously a horrendous scene. Mm. What's the mood like on a set for a scene like that? How do you, like, lighten the mood, or do you not?
I think it's important to stay professional in them sort of things, and respect Michael and Kelly, who are sat there uncomfortable in the pissing rain. Excuse me, in the pissing rain, sat on the floor covered in water and having to take themselves to a level that no human should ever have to go to. So you have got a sort of, I think, respect's a major thing in them sort of scenes. And we played it cool, and like you said, it all pays off when you watch the film, because it just looks so incredibly real,
doesn't it? And then you get the little Asian kid, bless him, with the tie around him and set him up as well.
Spoiler
alert if you haven't seen the film, but if you haven't, you need to check it out, because it is by far and away one of the best. I was saying to you earlier, it reminds me a lot. Have you seen the film Wolf Creek as
No.
well? It's a lot like that. That's an Australian similar sort of concept.
Oh, really?
But it's like that old Hills Have Eyes, Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Basically, you go into a small town, and you rub the locals the wrong way and you reap the fucking...
Yeah, well, it's weird talking about it, actually. I've not watched Eden Lake for, God, it must be about 6 or 7 years, maybe more. I mean, I remember when the film got released, I got a phone call from... I don't even think I had an agent at this point. Did I have an agent? No, I don't think I did. But I got a phone call from my dad saying, Thomas, because of his age, isn't allowed to come to the premiere.
Right.
But if he can travel down to London and walk down a red carpet and do all the press and then turn around and go home, that'll be great. So you can imagine what my answer to that was.
Did it involve two fingers? And obviously you didn't do that, I presume.
No, of course not. No, I just respectfully declined.
What was the first film you did then, or project, TV show or film, where you were unaccompanied by an adult and you're the adult for the first time?
So the first film that I ever did without a chaperone, it would be Scouting Book for Boys.
Right on.
And I would just turn 17, or was nearly 18. So we spent, I think it was about 7 weeks on a caravan park in Norfolk. Jesus, I'm dripping. I'm sweating here.
It's so hot, isn't it? Do you want to maybe put the window down a tiny bit?
Shall we?
Yeah, we'll see how it goes. Because there's not a lot of people walking past around this part, but we're literally like in a sauna right now, aren't we? There we go. Yeah, it's background noise anyway. It sets the scene. Oh, that's so much nicer.
It's nice, isn't it? Get that down. Yeah, so Scouting Book was the first one that I'd ever done without a chaperone. And we spent 7 weeks on a caravan park in Great Yarmouth. And it was the best experience I've ever had. It was like...
All living on there as well, staying in caravans.
All staying in caravans, yeah. All of the cast, all of the crew. And yeah, it was brilliant. I was sneaking beers in and yeah, it was really, really good fun. And it was sort of, it was a sort of a growing up. I sort of had to grow up overnight because I didn't have my chaperone telling me to go to bed or cooking me dinner. I had to do it all myself.
Were you disciplined enough at that point to be able to?
Yeah, I mean, I've been doing it now for about 12 or 13 years now, so.
No, I mean in that, shoot.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're filming now. I was thrown in at the deep end with This Is England. I tried the whole, I'll pull a sickie and I won't turn in for work. It doesn't work. It doesn't work like that. You can't just phone in sick and they'll get someone in to cover you because if that's the case, then you're not going to do the film. So
the show must go on, as they say, and it cannot go on without a key ingredient.
Exactly.
Can it?
So, yeah, I mean, I learned discipline from a very young age. So, you know, it helped. It helped me in so many ways in life. Being so busy and being so disciplined from the age of 13. So
I love that film as well. I didn't know what to expect. I only watched it, you know, probably about a year ago for the first time because I was going down the rabbit hole of your work, and I thought, oh, this is going to be like a nice coming of age romantic film because the soundtrack's all done by the dude from Noah and the Whale, isn't it? And it's got this beautiful soundtrack, and it starts off and you're kind of skipping above caravan roofs. I'm like, oh, this is going to be a really nice film. And then it takes this real dark turn.
Yeah.
And you're like, wow. And again, there's some really standout performances aside from that Rafe Spall.
Doing
his best East Midlands.
It's amazing.
Impression.
He was incredible. And again, I learned a lot from him. And we made a great friendship on that. And as I was saying earlier on, I was watching Black Mirror. And he popped up in one of probably the best episodes of the series. And he's just... incredible. He's like, he's amazing. Even from his really early stuff in like Shaun of the Dead. I mean, he's brilliant. So,
well, I love the pairing of him and Paddy in Hot Fuzz. And after watching
the
Scouting Book, I was like, that pairing makes complete sense now after seeing his performance in that film. I was like, there you go. It sort of all weirdly links around, doesn't it? And the writer or director of that film, went on to write the This Is England TV shows.
Yeah, so Jack Thorne then went on to write,
and the dude who did Eden Lake went on to do some Black Mirror episodes
Black
as
Mirror,
well.
I mean, it was
crazy.
It's such a tiny little industry when you think about it as a whole. I was saying to you earlier on that I don't think you'll ever go onto a film set and not know someone or know someone who knows someone.
Yeah,
it's a tiny little world, but it's good because you get this sort of like, you build this little community of friends and family, and it's amazing when you spend so much time apart and then you get back together and you're on the same job again. It's like, You sort of feel like you've got that little tiny piece of home with you. Do you know what I mean?
I get it completely. I go on a lot of tours, and when you go on a tour with a band, anywhere you then see them later on down the line, it's like instantly you're back to that place in your head. Do you know what I mean? And it's like you've got a friend for life in that person because you've been through this experience together.
Yeah, and although you might not see him every day and go to the pub with him every day, because when you're doing a film, or like you said, when you're on tour, you spend every minute of every day with these people for 6 weeks, and it's like you do become a family.
Yeah.
And then when you leave, that's why like rap parties are such a strange thing.
Bittersweet occasion, I imagine.
Like you spend in the days leading up to the rap party, you're like, yeah, we're going to get smashed. We're going to have a great time. But then you get there and it's like you have a couple of drinks with the people, with your family, and it's like it's such a sad thing. Like, I'll always remember the rap party for This Is England 90. It was like,
I was going to ask you, what was that like? Is that it for that?
I think that's definitely going to be it now. You never know with Shane. He's so busy doing his own thing now, and he's making other amazing series. And
he did that Liam Gallagher video, didn't he?
Yes,
for his single shot at King Tut's.
He's brilliant, and he did. He's got a new series that's coming out soon called The Virtues, and he's doing his own thing. So I think it's a good time to leave it. But the rap party for that.
So you all sort of knew that in your head, that this is the final time we're probably all going to be.
Yeah, and it went on for a couple of days, and it was sort of like, yeah, it was such a beautifully sad moment, like, because that's it. I mean, it's not it for us as friends. Like, we're all still best mates. We see each other all the time. You know, I've just been to Kendall calling with Gadge. And
you actually call him that as well.
He's the only one. For some reason, all of us, like, I've always been called Tomo. Sean's never really stuck for me, but...
And Woody never stuck, no?
No, I mean, it did for a bit, but then throughout the series, it was sort of like more Joe.
Yeah.
But Gadge, for some reason, it's just always been Gadge. Just, yeah.
You can be a family with people on the film set that you're in for that one specific project, but it's a completely different level of friendship and connection when it's an ongoing thing over years of your lives.
I mean, I grew up with these people. I mean, I say Andrew Shim and Andrew Ellis.
Andrew Shim is Milky in the films, yeah.
And Andrew Ellis is Gadge. I mean, they are genuinely some of my closest friends. Like, I've known them longer than I've known many of my other friends. And
were they brave enough to go on your stag do?
They was brave enough to go on my stag do.
They were there, were they?
Yeah, they was.
Tom, when was that? A week ago now?
That was about 10 days ago now.
You went out to Benidorm with 40 lads, you can imagine.
Yeah, so that got a bit rowdy. But yeah, there was a couple... There's a few of the lads from this. Michael Socker came, who played Harvey. And,
nice.
Gadge and Shim came. And yeah, we just had like an amazing time. It was one of them where you had to step back and just watch the lads and just be like, Jesus fucking Christ. You can still hear it in my voice now. I'm still a bit croaky. That's why I'm praying my voiceover agent don't ring me saying that can Nike want to do a voiceover or something.
You're like, hold on.
Yeah.
Can we talk about Summerstown? Because that, for me, is one of my all-time favourite, like, independent, low-key British films. I think it is so funny and so sweet and so beautifully shot. It's almost shot like a European film, isn't it? You've obviously got the Polish and the French actors within it, but it's the black and white thing as well. The subject matter is obviously very typically British, but the whole look and feel of the thing, very European.
Yeah.
And I love, like, what's the Polish lad's name?
Piotr Jagiello.
His and your, and especially when Perry's involved in it as well, the three of you.
Yeah.
The comic pairing of all of those scenes, the three key ones for me is when you're loading up his garage with all the chairs, when you just sat out on the field trying to sell the chairs and no one's buying them, and the best one is when you go to drop the bag of clothes outside his flat at 7 a.m. and he comes to the door in that leopard dress. Were any of those scenes actually like word for word scripted, or is a lot of that
you've never really got a word for it. Shane won't ever do a word for word scripted thing, I don't think.
Right.
I think he only writes his scripts to get the money from Channel 4. That's all
really?
He ever does.
And then goes and then out the window.
And when you get your sides on a Shane Meadows job, like for me, I'll never go onto a set without knowing my lines. But what on a normal job, you'll get there in the morning, you're like, right, I'll get my makeup and I'll sit there on my sides and I'll just double, triple, quadruple check that and know my lines. Whereas when you get given your lines on a Shane Meadows job, it's like, oh, you can just fucking fold it up and use it as roach if you want.
I'll wing it.
But because you know that, as long as you know the premise of the scene, you're good to go. And that's what Piotr was so amazing at. I mean, it was quite weird. Me and Piotr was born on exactly the same day.
Really?
So he's born on 11th of 2nd, 1992, both of us.
Oh, the same year as well. Exact same day.
Yeah.
What a strange...
We just got on so well because he just made me...
He's so dry, isn't he? And he plays it so straight.
Yeah.
And when he plays the drunk scenes, so convincing.
Amazing.
Like,
that was brilliant.
When you're on the rocking horses and he's like...
Yeah. And even the stuff when we're dancing around his dad's front room with the big bag of crisps and the vodka. And yeah, I mean, Piotr
was... that a happy shoot? That looked that to me brilliant. Like it was just you guys with, you know, very small crew just kind of doing comic improv. And
the crew was tiny and we was in central London, so it was manic. It was like we were shooting around King's Cross and St Pancras. It was only a 10-day shoot.
Is that all it was?
So it was originally meant to be an advert for Eurostar.
Okay.
That's what
So the whole idea is basically the final scene.
Yeah, basically we go to Paris.
Yeah.
But Shane shot so much in the edit, he was like, I can make this into a feature film. And lo and behold, he did that. And it was
so it literally became a feature in the edit?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Wow.
So I think, did we go back and do a few reshoots just a little, to sort of...
Tie it all together.
But yeah, man, we never knew it was going to do, again, in true Shane Meadows style. Like when we did This Is England, we never knew what it was going to be like. We never knew what it was going to do. So when we were shooting Summerstown, we just thought it'd be like a little internet video. And then it just blew up and it went amazingly. But I do genuinely believe that's down to to the crew all pulling together. We all mucked in so hard because if there's any actors listening, they'll know the fucking hassle of shooting in central London. It's not easy because you've got people who want to be cleaning the windows for 8 hours a day. Do you know what I mean? And they're not going to stop cleaning the windows unless they're getting paid 200 quid from you. And
yeah,
people want to know what you're doing. And especially in Somerstown as well, because it was quite a rough area. So there was loads of scraps of people falling out of pubs, fighting with pool cues. And
it almost looked like a ghost town as well. Like, there's not many scenes with background figures in.
No, there aren't really many. Yeah, that's a good point, actually. There was only one when I'm waiting, trying to get people to go into the shop for me to get beer.
Yeah,
so they was real people. They was,
were they really?
Genuinely real people.
Fantastic.
Shane was saying, when people come in, ask them if they'll go into the shop for you. And then if someone goes in, buzz in. If not, then yeah. So
wow. That's punk rock, man.
Yeah, Shane always works in such a real way. He likes to make everything as real as possible. Which is why it was such an honour when he rang me. As I finished filming Eden Lake, with 2 days to go, he rang me and he's like, what are you doing? What are you up to? Are you in London anytime soon? I was like, I'm filming in Pinewood at the minute. And he was like, will you come to central London the day you finish? Because we want to talk to you about another film. And I remember I was with my stepmom. She was my chaperone at this point. We went and met Shane again. Obviously, we'd stayed in touch. But this was the second time. Because I'd grown up and I'd done This Is England, an Innocence project, and Eden Lake, I knew my way around a film set. I knew what was what, and I was witty, and I knew what was happening. And then I was like, right, this is the chance to actually work with Shane now, my character was called Tomo, but to not be the little shit. And it was an amazing experience, and like, I can't thank Shane enough for the jobs that he's given me. But yeah, that more than ever, because it was nice to work with him and not be Sean. Do you know what I mean?
Dude, you're so good in that film and so funny. And there's two lines I want to ask you about. Were these made up by you on the spot? The one is when you go, it's called Love, Son.
When Shane gives you, because Shane will give you as much rehearsal time as you need. If you need 2 hours, then you'll get 2 hours. If you need 3 hours, you'll get 3 hours. And it's one of them that just popped in during the rehearsals, and that's what Shane finds the gold in these rehearsal things, and he goes, right, this is brilliant. You say this, da, 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 and you sort of write a script together there and then in the rehearsals. So
you write the character together, build it as you go. And the other line is when he brings in the dinner for you, and you go, there's not a lot there, mate. How much is your dad having? Like, the cheek of that, like, to be taken into someone's home and to be like, there's not a lot there, mate. Like, I want some of your dad's portion. Amazing.
Well, that was me. Like, that was what I was like. I was that cheeky little shit. And that's what people, for some reason, found so amazing when I was younger. I can't get away with it anymore.
It's an age thing, isn't it? As soon as you hit teens and above, like, you know, you're like a young adult, people are like, oh, you're just being a dick now. Whereas there's a cutesy thing there when you're younger, isn't it?
You can do whatever you want when you're a kid, can't you? So you can't really... Yeah, you're a bit more...
And Perry, man, what a character he is. I met him at a... So Jimi Hendrix's flat in London, where he used to live. They opened it up as like a museum.
Isn't Jimi Hendrix?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And he was there. He was sat on Jimi Hendrix's bed in the room, like dressed like he is in all Shane's films, with like a flat cap, glasses, like a sheepskin jacket, just there. And I was like, that's fucking Perry from all the show, man. And
what was you doing at Jimi Hendrix's house?
It was like a press launch night. So basically it was opened up that day, and you can still go and visit, I think. It's in central London, and you basically just walk around, you see the bed that he wrote all the songs in. And,
yeah, yeah.
And he was, for whatever reason, Perry was there. It's like, all right, son.
He's wherever you least expect him, he'll pop up. Yeah, he's a character. I'll give you that. There's never a dull moment when Perry Benson's on a set. Never. He's just so wacky and like.
Well, did he? Did he brilliant. Surprise you with the thing where he put his hand down his pants to get the money out, and you're like looking at it?
Yeah, yeah, that
was
all
genius.
It wasn't. It was minging. Even to this day, that's disgusting. Still, it's not worse.
We were talking earlier on, let's talk about Kingsman, because that for me is probably, am I right in thinking, the biggest budget film you've worked on today?
Yeah, without a doubt. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
How does a set like that then compare to Somerstown or This Is England, working with Shane, working very nitty gritty, rough and ready? Everything preordained? And
well, I've been asked recently a couple of times in interviews that at what moment have you stood back and gone, wow, like, this is amazing? And that is without a doubt one of them. I mean, Matthew Vaughan, it was the most bizarre thing. I was in a pub just round the corner, and
round here,
here, and I was with my dad, and it was on like a Friday afternoon. We'd been for a couple of pints, And I got a phone call from my agent saying Matthew Vaughn wants to meet you for Kingsman. And I was like, what do you mean? Like, he was like, he wants to talk to you about a role in Kingsman. And I was like, as in the new one that's they're doing now? He's like, yeah. So I was like, tell me when, I'll be there. So I got on a train to London with my mate. Oh no, me and my mate Connor, we drove to London, and I was just a bit bizarre. I was a bit, didn't really know what was going on. I was like, "What? I don't know what the part is. I don't know what it is." But me and Matthew, it's a really funny story.
And his history is interesting as well, because he went from obviously producing like gritty gangster films for Guy Ritchie. To then directing huge blockbuster like X-Men films. And
yeah, I mean, he's...
Kick-Ass he did as well, right?
Yeah, which were brilliant. He did, obviously, Eddie the Eagle, which is how we sort of met. So I was meeting Dexter Fletcher for Eddie.
To play
Eddie the Eagle. One thing, a couple of things got in the way, Taron being one of them, which not got in the way. I mean, he smashed that. He was brilliant. And that was one of them that when I watched that film, So when I watched that film, sometimes when you watch a film and you've been auditioning for a part, you go, oh, I could have nailed that. I could have done that. Mm-hmm. Eddie the Eagle, he absolutely nailed that. So I was buzzing with that. So through them meetings with Dexter and Matthew, that's when where Kingsman came from. So all in all, that me not playing Eddie Eagle paid off in such a brilliant way. So yeah, I went down to London and I had my tailor in, so I had to get me Kingsman suit fitted, and it was just like...
I bet that was an exciting moment.
Yeah, brilliant, because obviously I grew up watching Kingsman, and it's like, yeah, to be made a Kingsman was it was sick. So yeah, and just the sets and the green screens and bloody... Julianne Moore was milling around on set.
Is she as beautiful in real life as she comes across on screen? Because she's like my dream woman.
Just like, yeah, I mean, she was just milling around and just being Julianne Moore. I mean, she's cool. So
that's a cool part she has in that film as well. She doesn't often do comedic roles. No. And when she does, she smashes it. Like Big Lebowski, she's so funny in that. It was great seeing her in that kind of a wacky... eccentric role again.
And the same with Elton John as well. Like, it was when someone said that Elton John was doing it, it was like, oh God, what? But then watching the film, it's like, he's actually brilliant.
He's so good, isn't he?
He's really funny. So, that for me, the whole CGI, I remember I had to go into one of them camera trucks that they've got about, I think it's about 400 DLR cameras, all on different angles, so you have to stand with your hands behind your side, and all at once they take a photo, so then that they've got your whole pick, that everything about your body,
right, from
so
every that, angle,
from
every corner,
angle,
crevice.
Every corner, so
I've
every...
just seen you've got, is that a skull drawn on your leg? What is that?
No, that's a tattoo that I'm getting laser
is it actually a tattoo?
Yeah, so it's Stewie from Family Guy. So I got it.
Sorry,
when...
mate.
No, that's all right. So they've got every crevice of your whole body covered for the blue rash is what they called it. So, yeah, it was just a brilliant experience. Like, I'm just honoured to be part of that, definitely.
Have you ever had, other than Eden Lake, have you ever been in a death scene? Have you ever had a character killed off in any other film, or is that your only death scene to date?
No, that's my only death scene. People love me too much to kill me.
That's it, right? That is a pretty good way to go, isn't it?
Yeah, to get stabbed in the neck.
How did that go down?
But that was weird, because I'd say it was... I'd not really done any filming before. I'd never even thought about dying. And then suddenly I'm covered in blood. But I had to get this whole prosthetic head made. I remember I had to go to this little studio in London, and they put this whole prosthetics thing, and I couldn't blink, and I had to have straws as me breathing holes. And it was just like weird. But all the blood and all the gore just sort of made it easier. You just sort of go with it. And I still, to this day, the lads are taking the piss of how I played it, but yeah. It
was, are they?
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff going on in your eyes when I watch you in films, and I think some actors are very physical, whereas for me, you're all in the eyes. It's all in the eyes.
I put myself in the situations that I feel that the characters would be in, and I do try and...
So you do it in a very cerebral kind of a way.
Yeah, just trying to make it as real as possible, and just trying to make it as natural as possible. Like, you know, for the emotional scenes, you know, I'll always take myself to an emotional level that, excuse me.
It's that chips, isn't it?
Yeah.
Fish and chip dinner.
I'll always take myself to this emotional level that, you know, when you've finished your scene. I'll always remember one, I did a music video for my friend, and it's about mental health and a suicide. The song's brilliant. It's called Dear You by Lucy Spraggan. And we did the video, and you can see in there the emotional level that I took myself for that. you know, I was listening to songs that have had a major impact in my life, and you sort of go to this level that, you know, you don't ever really want to be at, but you'll do it for the, you know, for the characters and for someone that you believe in, you know.
Have what you've been through in your life, has that affected your craft and deepened your skill set in a way?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's affected. I mean, it's just, I always believe that there's good in every bad. I mean, you know, everything happens for a reason, and, you know, I sort of use the bad things that have happened in my life to make these scenes, these emotional scenes, as real as possible. And yeah, and I do, that's the sort of only time that I really do think about the bad things that have happened in my life. You know, I you know, there's not a day go by where I don't think about my mum who passed away, but I really, really think about it when I have to, you know, when I'm going to these levels, and, you know, and it doesn't just stop, you know, when they say cut, it doesn't just stop, because you've taken yourself to this emotional level that, you know, that can sort of, yeah, it can mess you up for hours and hours, and you sort of, you feel drained, and you want to just go back and just sort of, you know, just be alone and just sort of wind down.
Decompress and shut down, yeah. How long does it take you then?
It
differs how far you go.
Yeah, I mean, it just sort of, you just take yourself into this deep thought process that, but in a way it's rewarding, because you're thinking about the beautiful people that you've lost, and yeah, you just sort of take yourself to this level that, it's like emotionally beautiful in a way, you know, it's, yeah.
I think you're a really inspiring dude, man, because not only have you obviously been through some quite difficult stuff, but you obviously had fame and success and attention very early on in life. And you do look at the history of, let's say, child actors. Obviously, you were perhaps a bit older than what you might call the idea of what a child actor would be, from Macaulay Culkin and Drew Barrymore and people like that. But
yeah.
You certainly seem very grounded and humble and self-aware, and was there ever a period where you felt like you might go off the rails, or have you always had it in check?
I mean, I was surrounded by so many good people, i.e. the cast of This Is England and Shane Meadows and my dad and my friends, who would never ever let me walk around and pretend to be someone I'm not. I'm Tomo. What you see is what you get. And no matter what job I do, you know, I've worked in fish factories up and down the coast here in Grimsby. I've worked in my local pub serving pints. You know, I do what I need to do to get by. I'm just so fortunate that acting is such a beautiful way of earning money and life experiences. But no, I'd never ever. I've just sort of, and like we were saying earlier on, living in Grimsby as well is such an amazing thing, because it's such a treat to go to London and stay in a nice swanky hotel and go to the Kingsman premiere and, you know, and meet all these amazing people and do all these amazing things. But then I get on my standard class train ticket back to Grimsby.
Yeah.
And I go to my little two up, two down and argue over who's paying to fill the fucking cars up with fuel.
You know, I know who's losing that argument. Yeah, so,
yeah. But, you know, it's just that I'm with my fiance, Charlotte, like,
is she a big part?
She's a major part in my life,
and yeah,
you know, she'll always, you know, if I'm acting up when I'm pissed and being a knobhead, she'll always tell me. Even though she's sometimes like that. Should have seen her at Candle Calling on Sunday. She was on one. But you know, we're good for each other. We look after each other, and I think that's the key to happiness in life, and you know, and the key to any relationship as well. You know, you see people who are in relationships and they don't respect each other, and I think that's what a major thing in life is having respect, and that's when you do each other favours, and that's what Charlotte's done for me. She's always sort of made sure I'm okay and helped me out in my auditions and helped me out in my, you know, I struggle a lot with anxieties and things like that. She just helps me in every single way, so.
That's the true definition of a partnership, I think, isn't it? Is
we're a team.
On equal playing fields.
Yeah, we are genuinely
you've got
a team.
Each other's back.
Yeah. Definitely, like, and you know, people say, oh, we'll be together forever. Like, I do genuinely believe that me and Charlotte will be, because we are a team. Like, we do sort of, you know, we help each other out in so many ways.
Well, you're getting married, so I hope so.
Well, yeah, it's cost us enough
New Year's
money,
Eve, isn't it?
Yeah.
What a night to do it on. How did you two meet, dude? You've been going out 8 years, you told me earlier, right?
So, yeah, I met Charlotte when I would have been about 14, 15. So we've known each other for a long time. So we was friends, so there was a big group of girls and a big group of boys who hung around with each other.
From school?
From that we went to different schools, but we all lived in the same area. And Charlotte was in a long-term relationship before me, and I was in a long-term relationship before Charlotte. And we were friends. There was never any flirting or anything. And I split up with my ex, and she split up with her ex at the same time. And it was sort of, she was the only girl out of the group who drove, and none of the lads did. And I saw that as an opportunity. I was like, oh, she could take me to McDonald's later at night. She could take me here, she could take me there. And this is
dream
a genuine
big, dude,
truth.
Dream
there was
big.
No real, like, attraction in a way. Like, I always thought she was cool as hell, like, and I still do. But we just sort of, like, she'd come and pick me up, and she'd take me to McDonald's, we'd get a McFlurry, and it'd just be me and her. After everyone had left, we'd all be out as mates, and then we'd be texting. When everyone's there, we'd be texting each other going, oh, shall I pick you up after? And we'd just go cruising around. And then we'd just sit on my front, on my dad's front in the car for hours and hours and hours, just talking about shit. And, you know, and we still do that today. Like, we still can sit where we are now in the car and just talk. And that's just how we met. And that's how we just sort of started getting on. And
so it's like a friendship that evolved into this romantic connection.
Yeah, which I think's one of the reasons why we get on so well. Like, if we split up now, we would be genuinely fucked because we share the same mates. We've grown up together. We've got so much going on in our lives as a team. It'd be like, oh, God. Yeah, it scares me, really.
Unthinkable, isn't it?
Yeah, it really
does. Some of the best relationships I've had in the past have been with girls that I was good friends with beforehand. And it's almost like that foundation is laid and it's already there, isn't it? And you know it's strong and you know it's real. Mm. And you know you can have a laugh and you can take the piss out of each other. And I think those things, for me, are the definition of a great relationship, is a true friendship at the heart of it, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and I think making each other laugh as well, like you're saying, we have so much fun together. Like, some of my mates, they can't go out. They do go out with their girlfriends, but, like, say if I'm all a DJ and I'll take Charlotte with me, and some of the lads are like, I don't get, well, how can you go out and get smashed with your missus? And it's like, because she genuinely makes me laugh my head off, like, when she's pissed. And yeah, we just get on so well as friends, like you said. I think it's good that we've got that friend, sort of that our bottom line is friendship.
Yeah,
that we've just budded into something beautiful.
You got a good thing going on, dude.
Yeah.
And what about your dad? You got a good relationship with him, and is he incredibly proud of your career and how you've turned out as a young man?
Yeah, I mean, my dad was. I never really seen much of my dad when I was young. It was all down to my mum, really. She sort of wrongly sort of said that he wasn't interested. You don't need him. And when my mum passed away, I had to go live with my dad. I had no choice.
And you, at that point, I guess, didn't have much of a relationship.
And I didn't
have
much of a relationship. Obviously, I knew who he was, and, you know, we'd see each other at Christmas and birthdays, but other than that, there weren't really much. And I remember I sat in my, I bought an iPod, and I sat in my bedroom at my dad's house for days. I didn't want to leave, and I was like, I was in this weird sort of trance for 3 days. I didn't sleep, and it was weird. But then my dad sort of said to me on one Sunday morning, he said, I'm gonna go get the shopping from Asda, and we're gonna go sit in the Hawaiian Eye Cafe, just up here on the beach, and we're gonna get a breakfast and a cup of tea, and, you know, watch the tide come in and watch the boats go out. And we did that, and, you know, we just sort of slowly sort of budded this relationship together, and we started going to the town games. So every Saturday I was looking forward to it because I'd be at the footy with my dad, and then my mates started coming along with me, and then my mates started really, really, really respecting my dad. You know, we all always had this nickname. He was called the Major, you know, from the Green Street.
yeah.
Just messing around, like, and just these little relationships that my dad and my friends was having. And yeah, like, me and my dad now, we're really, really good mates. You know, we get on so well, and anything that I need, and he was. Because he's not very well at the moment, so he couldn't come on the stag do to Benidorm, but he was texting me every day like, please be careful, what are you up to, just, you know, just be careful with this and that. And, you know, yeah, we just get on so well. Like, we're off to see Liam Gallagher.
Are you going with your old man? Oh,
so
yeah,
my old
nice
man and the lads are coming, so we're just sorting an hotel and
Ashcroft in support. When Tomo picked me up today, he had Verve Lucky Man blasting out the window as he drove by. Tune. Let's talk about Game of Thrones. Were you a fan of that show before getting the call
on it? Well, I was watching. I got about two or three times. I must have watched the first couple of episodes and been like, fucking hell, this is slow. And then I thought, because everyone's banging on about it, I'm going to nail it. And then after like the fifth or sixth episode, I was like, it took over my life. And this is before I even had the phone call about that.
This is season one, right?
This is season one, and then I got season two, and then three, I think, I got the phone call. But I got an email saying, do you want to audition for something called The Big Tree? And I was like, what's The Big Tree? Not heard of it. And then my agent was like, it's Game of Thrones, but because of the security all around the script and everything like this, when you go to the audition, when you go to the... To the receptionist, you know, don't say you're Game of Thrones, you're Big Tree. So it was all really secretive. This was series 7, wasn't it?
It was the last one that was on telly, wasn't it?
Yes. So it was a very just sort of a brief meeting, really, with the casting director, and at that point I was genuinely like excited about the show
because you were like super fan of it.
I'm not just saying this, like I'm genuinely in love with the show. And then I started watching more of it, and then it got to series 5 or 6, and then it's just like, it's just amazing.
It's so good, dude. Amazing. Who's your favourite characters?
I mean, I love Emilia Clarke. I think she's so amazing. Good. But then Maisie Williams as well. Like,
I was going to ask you, because you're in the scene with her. It's Ed Sheeran as well, and we'll talk about him in a moment. But was there any time for a conversation with Maisie? Because she, I imagine, like you, has grown up on screen in this very iconic show. Did you feel any sort of a parallel, or was it all too hectic and brief to get into it on that level?
Maisie was just cool as hell. Like, she was just like, she must have been 19. So she just turned 18, 19. She was going out and she was talking about going to festivals and, you know, swimming in the sea late at night and just doing all kinds of, like, the shit that I did when I turned 18, 19. And we you know, we had a lot in common. Like you say, we grew up in the public eye, let's say, and, you know, and Ed Sheeran as well, he was chilled with us, and we were just sat just chilling and talking all day about the crazy stuff we've done. And I mean, some of the stories that Ed Sheeran had was, obviously I can't say, but
of course.
I mean,
well, didn't Jamie Foxx get his career going? This is what I heard, that basically he was out in LA busking. He had no record deal, nothing was going on. He basically just did like that 3-month holiday visa you can have to go to America. And he was basically just busking on the street. And apparently, so the story goes, Jamie Foxx saw this kid busking, or at that point, maybe he was at least playing open mic nights at clubs. Yeah. Jamie Foxx saw him and was like, what's the deal, dude? What's going on with you? And he's like, I'm just out here trying to get my career going. And Jamie Foxx apparently invited him to live at his house, use all his recording studio, and sort of helped get his career and running.
I've heard a story of him and Jamie Foxx, but yeah, I mean, that's incredible from Jamie. I call him Jamie like he's my best mate. That's good from Jay Dog.
Typical Jamie, that is.
Yeah, classic Jay. that's amazing. And I love hearing stories like that. And, you know, Ed Sheeran still does it now. And do you know what? It annoys me when... I wouldn't say I'm friends with Ed Sheeran by a long stretch, but... When people are slagging him off in the news and saying that he's building this tramp protector up his wall because he didn't want tramps in his doorway, it's like, that's not the case at all. He's just like, I'm not going into all that, but it does.
I think the public like to slander people who are successful.
Exactly,
don't they?
Yeah, and it's like to do it in such a way because he knows where he came from, and you know, his missus...
Well, look at all his tattoos. He's covered in them, isn't he?
He's covered
in
them.
And they're not, like, designer tattoos.
And his missus still works.
Really?
She goes and earns her own money. And she's like, you know, she's Ed Sheeran's wife-to-be or wife. And it's like, you don't need the money, but she wants to... They're just such, like, a normal couple. And he lives such a normal life as well. So, yeah, I mean, it annoys me. And it's the same with, you know, Maisie and Sophie Turner and all of the guys who are in these amazing things. You know, they get shit in the papers, and it's like, why can't you just support them and just let them do their own thing and let them bud, and you'll get more amazing things from them instead of them making them despise the people who are going along with these bullshit stories on.
It's a very British thing, I think. You don't really get that in America, that same sense of we want to tear these people down. And I think it's inbuilt in our psyche somehow that success is just like something that should be criticized and demonized. And as you say, like, people, I mean, Ed Sheeran isn't what I would call, you know, my type of artist, but are we all right?
Yeah,
I was
yeah,
just
we're
doing
good.
Some
yeah,
parking.
Yeah, yeah.
I hugely admire his talent and his skill set.
He's so talented. I mean, he's... And what annoys me is when Ed Sheeran was on the streets and he was busking, I bet people walked past and went, fucking get a job. And now he's the biggest superstar in the world. People hate him for that as well. It's like, what do you want him to do with his life?
Yeah.
And it's the same with anybody. Like, it just annoys me how people get on people's backs for either doing nothing or doing too well. And it's like, it's just a sad reality we live in nowadays.
I think it's always been the way, though, I think. So back onto the set of Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
What was the actual sort of filming experience like, other than bonding with those two amazing
well,
people?
I remember I got off the plane.
Was it in and out kind of a job? Or?
Yeah, it was. I think it was only one day's filming. I was in Belfast for 3 days. So day one, I got picked up in this massive, massive, like... I picked up in this huge, huge car, whisked away, taken to this. So they basically own the docks in Belfast. All of the warehouses are all sets, and it's like its own city. So I got put in this massive trailer, and Kit Harington was walking past, and Sophie Turner was milling around, and it was. And then I got put in this costume, and I got given like a big sword, and my cape, and I was like, "Wow!" I was like, "This is fucking amazing."
Was that the first time you donned the sort of swords and sandals
ever?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, it was like something I never
felt like you're
done.
In Gladiator or something.
It was amazing, and it was like, so I did that, got it off, and then I went and because I knew a couple of the guys who were shooting Series 7 anyway, so you know, I met up with them and we went for a couple of beers and spoke about it, and it was just like incredible because I was so into Game of Thrones at that time as well. And then I got picked up, taken to we was filming up a mountain in Belfast. It was about an hour away from the hotel. And it was minus sort of 15, and it was freezing.
What time of year was it? We're talking winter as well.
It was probably, November, December time. I probably did it.
Peak chilliness.
So, yeah, and I got the costume on, and we sat around the fire and, you know, chilling with Arya Stark and Ed Sheeran, and it was cool.
Busting out the jams.
It was just, it was people, you know, Ed Sheeran got a lot of stick for doing that, but fucking hell, the people who were giving them stick, like, if you got asked to be in Game of Thrones, would you not do it?
Of course, do you know what I mean? Like that scene as well, she goes, "I'm off to kill the queen," ha ha ha. And she's at that kind of moment in her character arc there where she's such a badass, like, she's seen and been through every kind of hell, her and her sister in the show, and both of them, like, you're rooting for them so hard, aren't you, as a fan of the show?
She's just such a badass, isn't she?
Such a badass.
I think
her and Tyrion are my two favourite characters.
Tyrion, yeah, he's quality.
He's amazing,
isn't
he?
He's brilliant. He's and Sophie Turner. I mean, I love Charlotte to bits, but I think if Sophie Turner asked me to marry her, I think I probably would.
She's gorgeous, ain't she?
She's amazing, yeah. She's brilliant.
And just, like, super tall, isn't she?
Yeah, she's just like...
She's a knockout.
Oh, she is.
Yeah. What about... Who's the actor who plays Ramsay Bolton? Do you know that dude?
What's his name?
He was in Misfits as well, wasn't he? He's another guy who's so good at being a baddie.
I can't remember his name in real life now. It's going to annoy me.
You have the same thing as me, don't you, where if you don't get an answer to something, you can't relax.
Bug me. But yeah, I mean, there's so many. I mean, I think Game of Thrones is slowly working with every single British actor.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, they're doing it.
If you hadn't had the call yet, you'd be kind of looking around going, well, what?
It's like Netflix. They're making, I think, was it 100 or 200 original scripts they was making this year? So I'm sat there going, it will come. I'm so into, like, the Netflix originals. I think some of them are fucking amazing.
Did you watch the one with, who is the girl who goes out with Justin Timberlake?
I don't
know. Oh, mate. I'll have to look it up later. I'm not going to do it now. But there's a show with her in it that is incredible. And it's like a psychological drama.
Oh, The Sinner.
Yes. Jessica Biel, The Sinner.
Oh, my God.
Isn't that incredible?
Me and Charlotte, literally, like, we sat and we thought, because I'd heard good things. So me and Charlotte said, we'll just whack one and see what it's on about. I think is it six episodes?
Only six, yeah.
We sat smashed and nailed it all. And we sat there at the end just like, just exhausted.
Heavy,
but,
isn't it?
Well, they're making another one.
Are they really?
So, yeah,
fantastic.
Another one.
Yeah, that, and obviously Stranger Things, dude. I mean, that is...
Yeah, I mean, I haven't got around to watching the second series. But I mean, the first series was like, just so incredibly made.
Incredibly
like,
made.
The episode of Black Mirror, is it San...
San Junipero.
San Junipero, yeah. Like... The way they're shot and the way they're made.
Just something about the 80s, isn't there?
Yeah.
I can't remember them being as good as they seem to have been when you were actually in it, but there's something about that nostalgia for the 80s at the moment. Almost like in the 70s, all the films were about the 50s, and it was all about car culture and diners and all of that.
Yeah.
And I think now we're in this very, like, 80s retro period with remakes of films like Ghostbusters and stuff.
Imagine in 1950 when they're making... films about nowadays, yeah. Like people in haraches with top knots shuffling away into Nando's. Just don't think
yeah,
that
I've no effect. Kind of nostalgia for that.
Yeah, yeah. Just me bezzing a banana seafront in my girlfriend's Audi.
Did you have to do much in the way of physical preparation for the latest film, Swimming with Men?
Yeah, I mean, the training.
Was that the first time you'd had to do that?
I mean, I swam a lot. The leisure centre that's just up the other end there, they did this thing called the aqua disco on a Friday night.
Is that literally what you'd imagine it would be, dancing in the water?
Literally, they had a big inflatable, put music on, had lights on. Me and all the lads would go, we'd see how many girls we can kiss, you know, just sort of, just being young and enjoying it. So I did a lot of swimming. When I had the meetings for Swimming with Men, they said, can you swim? And I was like, yeah, of course, I can swim. But then when we started our training camps, we had a 2 week training camp, got in the pool, and Adele and Katie, the two ladies from Aquabatics.
Oh, I thought you were going to say literally Adele.
Yeah, Adele got in and started singing.
Hello from the other side.
It turns out I couldn't really swim as much as well as I thought I could. So I had to have some more lessons. So I come back.
Because you were too busy snogging girls.
Too busy snogging girls. So I had to come back Grimsby. Come back to Grimsby. And I had to have swimming lessons at the age of 26 in my local swimming pool, which was quite fun.
It's for a role, guys. It's yeah. For a role.
So, but we had an intense training course for that. So we had 2 weeks of 6 hours a day, learning all kinds of routines, dry routines on land, in the pool. And it was intense and it was difficult and it was tiring. But when you got in bed at night, Jesus, you appreciate it. You was working so hard. When you got in bed, you was like, wow. You know, normally on a job, everyone would be like, oh, we'll go for some food after, we'll go for a drink.
Do some bonding. Yeah,
yeah, this was like, nah, everyone's off straight to bed.
Conked.
And then we learned so much during the shoot as well. I mean, the way the schedule worked, we sort of did the easy stuff towards the beginning. We become strong swimmers, and Adele and Katie, who was our trainers, they was genuinely blown away by how well we took to the water. Like our routines, we'd done all of the routines we did ourselves, all of the moves, all of the flips, everything was all us. We did everything ourselves. We didn't have no stand-ins.
You're like Tom Cruise, you do all your own stunts.
Do all my stunts in the pool, yeah. it was amazing. It was such a rewarding job, that. And, you know, throughout the whole 7 weeks, I didn't touch one drop of alcohol. I was eating well and I was training. I lost, God, probably nearly 2 stone doing that. And it changed my life as well. Like, I come off that job and I was like, do you know what? I'm going to join the gym. I'm going to swim more and I'm going to eat properly. And my lifestyle fully changed off the back of that job. And, you know, it changed my life in so many brilliant ways, just like This Is England did. Like, I live such a healthier lifestyle now.
Nice. It must have been really fun working with that cast of, like, basically all middle-aged men, isn't it?
Well, yeah. Yeah, yeah, there was all sort of, you know, well past the 30s, you know, and you know, I mean, Jim Carter's probably 65, maybe 70
wow.
even. So, yeah, there was all sort of that little bit older, but we just, like, yeah, it was amazing. It was a brilliant experience, like, the whole cast on that was incredible, you know.
Who's left on your list of actors, first of all, that you'd love to work with, particularly British? Because you've kind of worked with a lot of the cream
yeah,
of the crop,
I mean,
from
I've
all
been
ages,
so,
haven't you?
So lucky. I mean, off the top of my head, I mean, there's so many. I mean, I'd love to work with Jim Broadbent. I think he's incredible. Who else is that I'd love to work with? I mean, Tom Hardy, I'd love to. I do know him. We've seen each other a lot. We get on really well. I'm really good friends with his wife Charlotte. But yeah, I mean, I'd love to work with Tom Hardy. And yeah, there's so many brilliant. So off the top of my head, I couldn't name them all.
Director wise,
oh God, I'd love to work with Ken Loach, Danny Boyle. Just a sort of old school British.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Swimming with Men was very much in that kind of like Brastoff, Full Monty, classic British comedy, wasn't it?
Have you seen it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Think? I mean,
yeah.
It's
just in that vein of feel good.
Yeah.
Like,
it's exactly what we wanted from it.
Kind of relatable, everyday.
It's exactly what we wanted
uplifting.
From it. When we was making it, we knew it wasn't going to be. When you walk out the cinema after watching Ready Player One or Jurassic World, you're like, fucking hell, that blew me up. Whereas this, we knew this was going to be the kind of film you walk out the cinema and you go, That was lovely.
That was nice, wasn't it?
It's a nice film, that, yeah. And you feel good. You know, all like, and that's exactly what happened. I remember we watched it in Edinburgh for the first time. I was on a night shoot the night before in Hartlepool. And we had to get up really early. I think I got to bed, a night shoot, went into, got up straight away, drove straight to Edinburgh. I'd not seen the film before, and I took Charlotte, and we did the red carpet. We wore a nice suit, and the cinema was the most beautiful cinema. And watched it, and me and Charlotte was just like, when we got out, we was ringing, like, I rang my dad, and she rang her mum, and, like, we was genuinely, like, so happy with
it. Beaming,
like, yeah. It's just one of them, like, when... Normally, I sort of cringe a bit when I watch my own jobs back, but with that, it was like I really, really enjoyed watching it. Like, it brought a smile to my face. And then I watched it a couple of days later in London, and it's the same again. It was, you know, it's just, yeah, it's a brilliant little film. So, yeah, I'm chuffed with that, definitely.
Good man. What is, as we get towards the home straight, if you have one, could you pick one, like your favourite scene that you've ever shot, either because you just particularly... proud and pleased with the performance you put in, or because the experience of doing it was something very transcendental and magical? Is there one that stands out as like you were flying on some kind of higher plane at that point?
I think it would probably be with Swimming With Men, the final performance.
Do you know? Because of all the hard work that had gone into it, and it all coming together.
So hard, and that was the last day of shoot, and it was like, and there was a big crowd, and all the extras, there was probably 200 extras. And there was a big crane.
So it is like a real life show.
And it was a real life show. Yeah, and it was, and the film was based on a documentary called...
In Sweden, was it?
In Sweden. Yeah. So the Swedish national team in the film, that's the actual team. They played
nice.
From the documentary.
Yeah,
actually played the Swedish
team.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a unique concept, isn't it? Because it's so British, the film, but then you're like,
So watching that final sequence is like... Because you're really jeering them on, and when they all go underwater and they're all like, are they going to do the flip? They're going to do the... And then it's all slow motion and the soundtrack and just... Yeah, and like in the cinema when that happened.
It needs to be in the cinema moments
like
that, doesn't
it? It was like, yes! You know,
was it a proper...
It was. Everyone was like buzzing. Yeah, it was. Yeah, it's, yeah. That's for me, my favourite one to watch and the most proud.
Good times.
Yeah.
Love it. Had a good time?
Yeah, I've enjoyed it. It's been warm.
It's been fucking boiling, isn't it?
Well,
thank you for sweating balls with me.
No,
is there anything? Oh, let's talk about your podcast.
Yes.
So you're going to be launching a new podcast with Gadget, and the concept and the title. Tell us all about it.
So it was a random thing. We was DJing in Nottingham, and beforehand we went to a pub called The Globe in Nottingham City Centre, which has become quite a local of mine, actually. I quite like it.
Shout out The Globe.
Shout out The Globe. We was talking, and we just said, like, we'd both been... listening to Scroobius Pip, and we'd both been listening to
Life in the Stocks.
Life in the Stocks. And Two Shot Podcast with a friend of ours, Craig, who hosts it. And we thought, it'd be brilliant if we did one, because we get on so well and our conversation's flowing. And we was talking about things that are overrated. And he said to me, he thinks football's overrated. Straight away, I was like, are you fucking kidding me? Like,
yeah.
And I spieled off 101 reasons why I thought football wasn't overrated. And we went, that's our concept.
Yeah. And no one's doing anything quite like that. It's almost like a reversion of Room 101, isn't it?
Where you're
putting something in, you're actually going, no, we're taking it out of that room and saying why it is worthy.
Yeah. It's that sort of concept. So we've recorded our first couple, and we've had... subjects, so our guests come on with a subject that they feel is overrated, and it's our job, our guests as hosts, to show them why we feel like that
to champion and defend
to defend
what they're going
in
subject.
On. So not to give any of the subjects away, but there was one that was like mind blowing, and without
the one you told me in the restaurant,
and without that, the world wouldn't be the same place. But they were saying it was overrated. So it's called Overrated Everything. We've got some brilliant guests lined up, and yeah, we're just sort of waiting for the right time to release it. So yeah, if you want to,
it's all about the launch, dude. It's all about that first opening guest and how you come out the gate. But what I'll do is hold back on this until you've got all your ducks in line.
Yeah.
And then we'll come out the gate around the same sort of time, and everybody can then
That'll be great. Yeah.
And you're on Instagram. It's Thomas Turgoose 1, right?
Yes.
Is your handle on there? Same on Twitter?
Twitter's Thomas Turgoose, yeah. Yeah, and yeah, that's about it. That's all I use.
And keep online, keep up to date. Yeah. Have you got anything else going on film-wise which we could divulge or discuss at this point, or is it still...
There's a couple of little things. So I shot a film recently. It's quite a funny story, actually. So whether anyone's heard of it, we did a short film that did really well in the industry. We won a British Independent Film Award for it called Jacked. So we shot this short film called Jacked, which is about a couple of young professional car thieves in London who work for someone high up, and we steal cars for them to do jobs with, and we end up finding these cassette tapes, and we've stolen a car off a dying man, and it's about the guilt of one character dealing with it and the other, like, it's a job, So we toyed around with the idea whilst we were shooting this short film called Jacked. We toyed with the idea of making it into a feature film, and then 3 years later, we got the green light, we got the funding, and we've just finished filming that in Hartlepool. Now, the title's now changed to Looted, but all the cast, all the crew are all the same. The same sort of premise, but there's more going on. And I got to work alongside some amazing, amazing actors. Charlie Palmer, who is Patsy Palmer, of course, from EastEnders and the like, son. Morgan Polanski, who's Roman Polanski's daughter, and you know, she's amazing. We just got a great little cast together, and I think it's going to do really, really well. That they're editing it at the moment, so yeah, keep your eyes out for
Will that
Looted.
Be out by the end of the year, or
they're trying to get out by the end of the year? So you know,
we should talk about Terminal as well, real quick.
Yes,
what a bonkers film that is.
I've not actually seen
Have
it.
Have you not?
I've
My
not
God,
seen
mate.
It yet.
I watched it because I was chatting to a friend out in LA who works with Simon Pegg. He's his publicist.
Yeah.
And he was like, oh, you've got to see this new film he's done with Margot Robbie. Just like some insane, like, surrealist 50s-esque kind of diner film, but then with all these other noirish, and then there's almost like a Tarantino Guy Ritchie style dialogue and flow to it.
I remember reading the script and it being like,
Jesus. It's just a bonkers cocktail of...
Yeah,
styles and elements.
I've not seen it. Like they didn't do a premiere or anything. Well, if they did, they didn't invite me. But that was an experience in itself. Like going. So again, I was driving just up the road from here, and I got an email from my agent saying, Margot Robbie, Simon Pegg, Mike Myers, Max Irons.
Mike Myers, dude, you
Mike
must have been like, yeah, Austin fucking
Powers,
Wayne's World,
the Love Guru, and you know, just like. And
Dexter Fletcher.
And Dexter Fletcher, who obviously I knew from meetings with Eddie the Eagle and met through the circuit and whatnot. But I got an email saying I'd like to offer you a role. And I was like, and I read it, and it was only a tiny little role. But I mean, I got flown out to Budapest, put in the most beautiful apartment. And I was stood on set talking to Margot Robbie, just chilled, just like talking about football and just talking about any old shit. And it was like, you know, like Margot was... Well, you can only imagine, you know. She was just as beautiful to talk to as she is to look at. And same with Mike Myers and, you know, Simon Pegg. Yeah, it was a great experience, yeah. But I should get around to seeing it. Is that my radio?
No, it was a car that went past us.
Yeah, I should get... Should
is Mike Myers a rad
that.
Dude? Is he cool?
Yeah, he was cool, man. Like, yeah. He was just like... Just proper cool, yeah. I didn't want to bother him for a photo because he was... But I mean, it's like, it was so hard not to ask Donkey from Shrek for a photo. Ask Shrek for a photo, but yeah, it was cool. It was a bit of a surreal experience, but yeah.
Who's the nicest or coolest or just like most down-to-earth and disarmingly fucking genuine actor star you've met and come into contact with? You're like, wow, what a cool...
I mean,
guy
Johnny Depp
girl.
Was cool. I mean, that for me...
How'd you meet him?
Well, so forgive me, Charlotte, for talking about this, but my ex-girlfriend was a massive Pirates of the Caribbean and Johnny Depp and Tim Burton fan, and Stephen Graham did Public Enemies with Johnny Depp. And Stephen rang me and he was like, look, he said, I know Shona loves Johnny Depp. Do you want to come up to the premiere of the film? And I was like, wow, yeah. Oh, you know, we've got a wasp.
We've got a My Girl situation. Is he gone?
Yeah, so so I got the phone call from Stephen. He just said, do you want to come to the premiere? And I was like, fucking hell, yeah, why not? So Stephen, bless him, paid for our train, put us up in a hotel. And Stephen, after the film, vaguely met Johnny Depp walking up and down the carpet, and obviously he's Johnny Depp, so I was sort of a bit like, ooh. But after the screening, we went to a party, and we got taken into a room with Stephen, and Johnny Depp was there, and we just spoke about, again, just about football and about women, and just like just random shit, just
bloke
like
stuff,
just
normal
bloke
stuff.
Yeah. And yeah, I mean that was pretty out there. And Tom Hardy as well. He's just like he's cool, man. He's just like, yeah, he just talks and up like he loves his motorbikes and stuff. So yeah, just chat about any old shit. And that's what I love. Like, you meet all these big stars, but it's nice to just chat about any old shit. Like, the amount of...
It's all right, that's a ladybird.
The amount of times that people have met Johnny Depp and spoke about how amazing Jack Sparrow is, or Charlie in the Chocolate Factory, where is it? It's probably a breath of fresh air for someone to talk
about
cars and football.
A normal conversation, everyday stuff.
Yeah, yeah, and that's exactly how it was. So, yeah, it's probably...
And he likes to get bang on it.
He likes a bit of a party, doesn't he? Yeah.
Dude,
famously.
Thank you so much
pleasure.
For your time, mate.
Absolute
really
pleasure.
Enjoyed it. Thank you for
you.
Coming on the show. Good luck with the podcast and everything. And
thank
good
you.
Luck with the tattoo removal. So there's that almost complete, is it? It's phase.
There's a couple more sessions. Yeah, the ink's coming out slowly now, so.
That's funny, man.
Yeah.
I wonder what that was. Stewie tattoo, anyway.
Yeah, it really, really hurts, the laser removal.
I'll bet.
Yeah.
Don't do it, kids. If you're going to get a tattoo, think it through twice.
Defo.